Welcome to another webinar of the Crypto and DLT Meetup at the University of Bayreuth. Again, we are hosting this webinar today, not in a physical forum as we did the last semester, but in an online forum via Zoom. So we are very delighted that everybody of you is here today and is listening to the talk by Martin Schaeffner from Datarella. We will have Martin here today to talk about a very interesting use case of blockchain technology, which is in the field of digital identities. And more precisely, Martin will talk about blockchain-enabled self-sovereign identities. Martin, we are very, very happy to have you here today. And yeah, the stage is now yours. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks again for having me here today. I'm really excited to talk about one of my favorite topics, self-sovereign identity. As you already said, it's one of the best use cases for blockchain applications, and also one of the most interesting topics in the blockchain space right now. So feel free to ask me any questions that I will answer then after the call. And yeah, I'm excited. Before we start with the actual topic, I just want to give a quick introduction about who am I? My name is Martin Schaeffner. I'm blockchain architect at Datarella, and I'm specialized on self-sovereign identity, where I also wrote my master thesis last year about SSI at the Technical University of Munich. And so I'm very excited to share you some insights from me here. Besides self-sovereign identity, I often focus on system design, like creating a system architecture or requirements engineering of together with our customers, and also focus about governance in centralized and semi-decentralized systems, and decentralized and semi-decentralized systems. Now about my employer, Datarella. We are a very successful blockchain solution provider located in Munich. And we were founded in 2013 and do blockchain solutions since 2016. We have many customers in various business fields, for example, in humanitarian or in a mobility context, also payment, and developed some super interesting products, for example, the building blocks product, where we currently have 500,000 refugees in Jordan refugee camps that are using a blockchain-based payment and accounting system. And that system is also deployed in some use cases in Bangladesh. We have about 50,000 people using the system. And Track and Trust is our supply chain solution for tracking of humanitarian goods. And furthermore, we have wallet applications with corporate partners for us, with us, and many more. Also, we are running one of the most of the largest meetups in Munich called Blockchain Munich, where we have almost 3,000 members to the date. Okay, to begin with, I want to raise awareness about current problems we have with online identities. And here you can see just a few of many examples of what can happen to our online identities. So either we share data, like sensitive data of ourselves with some online services who should store this data securely. However, it often happens that there's a major breach and all this data will be or gets in the hand of criminals who then take advantage of that in some way. Furthermore, identity theft is a problem, especially online, where it's relatively easy to imitate being another person. And also, we don't know what happens with our data when we give them to the services. Like Cambridge Analytica has shown us, we don't know what happens with our data. The problem itself aren't the online identities. The main problem is that the internet, as we know it, has no identity layer implemented. So there's no way that you natively can say, I am the person who I am, and that's a big issue. And that is the price that we are paying here, as you can see in the headlines. But that's not forever, because SSI aims to be the missing identity layer all over the internet, so that you can use this identity independently on which service you use, in which country, from which country. So that's pretty cool. But let's start at the beginning with regular online identities or digital identities. That's very important for a self-sovereign identity to understand the basics here. And a digital identity represents any entity inside a digital system or environment. And we assign information to this identity to describe it further and to give it a context. There are three levels of identity I want to present to you. The first one are the normal identity characteristics, like for a person, for example, the name or the date of birth. And if you have a machine or a car or anything else, a model number could be a characteristic of it. And these characteristics help us to distinguish one identity from another. The second level are then the identity representations. So how do we authenticate ourselves to others that they can verify we are who we are? We usually do this with persons using passports, but we can also use any sort of other credential, like a club membership card, for example. With these representations and with the characteristics, we can then perform identity interactions. They define where we can use the identity and how we can use them. In the case of the club membership card, it is only valid in the environment of this club we signed up for, and how we can use it could be, for example, to get access or to book some special services this club offers to us. So these are the three levels of identity that are very important for self-sovereign identity, as you will see in the next slides. Now, before we start with the actual definition of self-sovereign identity, I want to talk about identities you probably all use. We name them conventional digital identities. Here on the left side, you can see a Google icon and an Apple ID, which indicate that these are one of the most used online identities, as probably most of you who are watching this have either one of those. These are very powerful digital identities, as you can access so many different services with it. For example, you can download movies or music with Apple ID, or you can create presentation like this on Google. So that's super powerful and very, very useful. But we all also know these, hey, create an account here in order to access our page offer. That's a little bit annoying, because when we have to do this, we have to remember a username, we have to remember an email maybe, and also a password, and that's just annoying over the time. However, these identities have lots of benefits and are super useful, but in context for self-sovereign identity, I want to focus more on the problems we have with them. First of all, we rely on the centralized institutions or the service providers on the internet. Like, for example, Google or literally any other online service we sign up for. The problem with that is that these identity providers run the server. So if Google or Facebook is down, which of course doesn't happen often, but then you cannot use identity online, which is pretty bad, because you oftentimes depend on these identities. And it's just annoying if these don't work, or even worse if you get censored or your identity gets deleted by the identity provider because of some reasons. Therefore, the identity we have here is only borrowed and not owned. And that's a very, very bad thing. It is a bad thing because the user has no control, and also we don't know how the personal data we have provided to this service provider are shared with other people. So there's no way we can give explicit consent to how data is shared. The next point is that the identity provider needs to protect the information we provide against outside attacks, because we trust the service provider and we don't want that this information falls into hand of third parties. The next point is stating a not necessarily a trustworthy identity. Therefore, I mean, if I sign up with a Google account at some official office to get an official document, or to get a bank account, I always have to perform a KYC process, because based on my native identity I provide them, they cannot say that I'm actually who I claim to be. And the last problem is that to verify that a site belongs to an actual owner is there are two. One is root certificate authority, and the second one is intermediate certificate authority. And if they don't do the job properly, then you have that HTTPS, that your connection. However, it might be possible that the owner of the website is not the one that is claimed.
Martin, I guess we cannot hear you anymore.
Sorry, I have some internet problems here, but I hope the connection stays stable.
Okay.
So sorry for that.
No worries. And you do not lose your video, right? Because that would be good for your connection then.
Oh, okay. Yeah, maybe I turn off my camera.
Maybe it's then better. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Okay, I just start again with this page about, or this slide about self-sovereign identity. The conceptual background of it is that
your screen is not shared.
Oh. Yep. Can you see it now?
Yes, we do. Thanks.
Okay. Perfect. So also, sorry for that. let's continue. Okay, the conceptual background is that self-sovereign identity should act as the missing identity layer all over the internet, as I said earlier. And the user should have full control over its identity and how it is used. And it is also possible to attest personal information in the form of verifiable credentials from or to others. And now to the technical background. We are using blockchain or distributed ledger technology to independently create and manage the identifiers. So there's no third party or no centralized institution that can permit us, or that can limit us in our ability to manage our identifiers. The next step is that this information is stored in a digital wallet, for example, on your smartphone in the form of an app that allows to store identity information and to perform interactions with others. And the third aspect is that we implement cryptographic signatures through the public and private key pair we are using to make the system more secure or to make the identity information more secure and to verify uniqueness so that only your only you can perform operations with your identifier and no one else. Here now we have a comparison of conventional versus self-sovereign identities. Just to make it more visual, on the left side here we have a user in the middle of the action, and where these four different online services request the user to create an own identity on their side. So the user has to create this identity four times and doesn't know what happens with that identity exactly. On the other side, we have the self-sovereign identity, where only one identity is created and all the other online services request access to specific data from this identity so that you can then define what you're sharing with them. On this point, I want to mention that you most probably have more than one identity, self-sovereign identity, just because of the reason that if you don't want, for example, that Zoom knows you also have a connection with Amazon, then you just create a new identity, especially for Zoom. And so Zoom has no idea or has not even a chance to know that you are also on other web services. Now let's come to the more technical part of my presentation. Here on the left, you can see the SSI components architecture. We have some ledgers on the bottom that basically indicate the blockchain or distributed ledger technology that is compatible with self-sovereign identity. On top of these ledgers, we have DID methods. These DID methods define how to create and manage DIDs. So this could be, for example, a smart contract on the Ethereum blockchain, where you then can invoke functions that allow to create or update or delete your identifier. These are identifiers are called decentralized identifiers or DIDs that you store in your wallet. And based on these DIDs, it is possible to attest verifiable credentials to them to give it or to personal information to it. And based on this information, you can create verifiable presentations that you can then share with others. And these wallets are then managed by the user itself or by the entity itself. Now let's come to decentralized identifiers. They are actually the heart of self-sovereign identity, as they uniquely identify an entity that is using it. It's further backed up with a key pair, so a public and private key pair that allows you to operate any cryptographically verifiable operation. It's independently derived from a blockchain, so no one can stop you from creating as many identities as you want to. Over its lifetime, it never changes. So whatever public keys you're using for this DID, it always stays the same. And it's privacy preserving. As you can see, this DID is not human readable. It's some string of letters and numbers, so there's no way you can tell who's the entity behind the DID just from the identifier. Now, if you take a closer look at the identifier, it always has the same syntax. It has a scheme, which is by definition always DID. Then you have a method based on the DID method that you are using to create your decentralized identifier. In this case, it's SOV, which stands for sovereign. However, there are about 70 officially registered DID methods. For example, there's also BTCR for Bitcoin, or YOLO for YOLOCOM. And all these have then a method-specific identifier, which distinguish this entity from another. Based on this DID, there are many cool things related to it. The first one is the DID document, which describes the DID further. I will tell you more about that in the next slide. Then we have DID resolution, which allows you to get from a DID to the DID document, so that you then know how to interact with the DID. And you have DID auth, that is a protocol to prove ownership over a DID. And now, if you look at this decentralized identifier, you probably think, oh, what can I do with that string? And the thing is that this DID is only the key, and the DID document is the value. Here on the left side, you can see a minimal form of a DID document. And as you can see, it has some data in it that help to further describe the DID document. For example, it always shows to which DID it is actually connected, so that there's always a link between the DID and the DID document. And the next step is about authorized keys. In the second box, you can see the keys minus one string at the end of the key. It indicates that only the first key is actually authorized to perform authorization or authentication. And the third box then shows where the actual public key should be placed. And the fourth box shows service endpoints. So that when you have resolved the DID document from the DID, you know how to start interactions with that DID. And as this is just the minimal form of the DID document, it is further possible to add more information, and for example, more public keys or a signature for audit purposes, or also a timestamp that shows when the DID document, and therefore the DID, was created or changed for the last time. Earlier, I talked about verifiable credentials, which is also a key element of self-sovereign identity, as they allow the users to trustfully attest and share personal information to an identity. It's like the DID format. It's a standard in the SSI ecosystem and can hold any type of credential. A classic example is a passport, but it could also be any claim you can make about someone else. For example, he has blue hair. The verifiable credentials are always linked to a special DID to which it was issued to. There are also proofs in it. It is cryptographically verifiable. Another cool point is that these credentials can be attested and received by anyone in the system. So all DIDs have the same rights. So if you feel like you should issue credentials, no one can stop you from it. The only question is if the credentials you are issuing are indeed trustworthy. And even more cool, there are no need for data troves anymore. In order to verify that a user accessed the service, the verification takes place when the user tries to access the service. I will show you this later in a little example, but the user will then be requested to publish information about him, and based on this information, an online service can then verify that you are indeed eligible for it. On the left side, you can see how a credential is built up. These claims or the credential value is located in the claims portion, and where at least one claim should be inserted. The metadata describes, among other things, who issued the DID and to whom. And the proof is the proof indicates that the issuer actually issued this document. In the process of verifying, of issuing a verifiable credential, there are four roles: the identity subject and the identity owner, which are oftentimes the same person or the same entity. And you have the credential issuer and the credential verifier. In a process, this looks like this. So this is an example from the university. So on the left side, you have the issuer, which is the university, that publishes its DID on the ledger so that anyone else can verify that this DID belongs to the university. And then it is possible to issue a credential to a student, for example, a diploma, which the student then stores in his wallet. And now that he has it in his wallet, he can use it to present his credential to verifiers, for example, a company he likes to apply. And so then the verifier receives the credential or the credential information and verifies it against its own requirements. And in order to make sure that the credential is actually true, it looks up the DID. And then sees it as correct or as not correct. I have provided some examples how this then could look in reality. Here we just want to apply for a driver's license credential where we are using screenshots from a YOLOCOM demo. YOLOCOM is also a self-sovereign identity infrastructure provider. As you can see on the left, you can sign up with Facebook or Google, the more classic ones, or you can continue with your YOLOCOM self-sovereign identity. Which you can see on the left picture. In the middle, you can see that we have already an ID credential, as you can see on the top, that contains all the important information about the objects. In this case, me, like my name, my date of birth, and or my birthplace. And now, if you want to have a driver's license and you passed the driver's license test and you just want to have this credential, try to access that service and that gives you the driver's license, you will be requested to provide information from your ID credential, and then just hit the check, as you can see here on the right, and then share your claim. And after that, an automatic verification takes place, and you receive your credential, your driver's license. Another big topic in self-sovereign identity is interoperability. Here you can see on the right side, you can see the architecture of Hyperledger Areas, which is a toolkit for interoperability And one of these tools is the Bitcom protocol that is useful to communicate with other devices, for example, to exchange your credentials or to do some key management or make some payment operations. That's what Bitcom is for, so between the different devices or agents. Then the next point is the universal resolver. As I said earlier, the universal resolver allows to resolve the DID document that is important to start interactions from the DID. And since Hyperledger Arias has this pluggable resolver interface, you can plug to any DID method that is existent in the universal resolver. And that's how you create interoperability between the different devices and different DIDs. Now I just want to give you some potential use cases where it would make sense to use a self-sovereign identity. For example, the university context, as I said earlier to you, we can have here an automated application process so that a high school student provides information about his diploma he got from high school, which can then be automatically verified and checked by the university so that the applicant gets immediate response if he is enrolled or not to the university. And furthermore, as I described earlier, the university could issue diplomas. The next use case is the municipal context. Here you could, for example, perform e-voting if you have a credential from the municipal office or from the German Bundestagswahl. That allows you to perform a verified e-voting from at home. But you can also do some administration tasks, for example, file a marriage or change your residency or something like that. And then the last use case is the mobility context. So if you think about that machines or cars have their own identity, you could easily track who's currently the owner of this machine or.
Wait, kar raha tha ye bolne ke liye. Webinar hi to hai yaar, office ka koi kaam hai kya?
Sorry, could you please unmute yourself?
Yeah. Thank you. So yeah, this would be a third very high potential use case. Now on my last slide, I want to give a quick summary on what we have learned about self-sovereign identity. So SSI acts as the missing layer all over the internet. As I said earlier, you can use it on every service. It's all standardized and nothing stops you from using it. The good thing is that you then have control over your identifier and how and with whom you share the information and using the verifiable credentials and verifiable presentations. And further, there are no need for centralized institutions. You can do everything by yourself. It's all up to you. It's almost entirely decentralized. Further, it brings a high potential for automation and increased security. And also highly usable. It has an intuitive design. You just have to do some clicks and verify, for example, with your fingerprint. And you don't need to remember all your passwords for all the online services you're accessing. However, self-sovereign identity is far from being complete. There are still some obstacles it needs to overcome. One big challenge is the need for trust anchors to leverage its potential. If you think about the e-voting use case I mentioned in the slide earlier, that would just be possible or only be possible if you have a one-to-one digital copy of your ID with you. And in order to achieve this, we need trust anchors, like the municipal office where you can create your identity when you pick up your physical ID, or the Bundessupervei provide some functionality to issue this credential. The next part is that the key backup and recovery is not ideal. So the problem is that people will lose everything connected to their ID. They will lose their private keys and stuff like this, which makes it very difficult to recover the identity, and which is not the goal, because identity loss would be or could be very dramatic in many cases. And the last point is that SSI is still in its early stages, and we ask yourself how it will be adopted, because it's more like a chicken and the egg problem. The online services say, hey, we only use this when SSI becomes more common with our users. Or the users say, why should I use an SSI if I can not use it anywhere? Anyway, this all leads to the fact that self-sovereign identity is a very promising concept with a high potential to change how we use the internet and who should make it all safer and more intuitive to use and overall more secure. And that was my presentation. Thank you very much for joining me here. Feel free to ask me any questions, and thank you for having me.
Perfect. So thank you a lot, Martin. Very, very interesting presentation again. And as we said, we are now going to the Q&A session. So I just posted again the Slido link and the event code in the chat. So you can all ask questions now. We also have received some questions. So if you have some more, we give you maybe 1 minute to answer your question and to upvote it. And Arthur will moderate the Q&A session now.
Exactly. Can you hear me?
We do, yes.
Yes.
All right. Perfect. So I'll quickly share my screen. So then...
Okay.
We can get back to the questions.
I try to start my video again. It makes it maybe more.
Yeah, sure.
All of us.
Okay. Hi. I'll just have to find where I can share my screen. Ah, there. Obvious. Right, now you should see all the questions, right? So actually all the top voted questions first. So I would say we can go from top to bottom. So which blockchain framework do you use at Datarella SSI?
That's a good question. I don't want to start a flame war here, because all different blockchain frameworks have their use. At Datarella itself, I don't know if that's only it's now for our applications or especially for self-sovereign identity. For the applications we use is mostly Ethereum based, as this provides us with the best functionality that fits our use case very well, and that we can perform that we can create high-performing applications. So far, we are very happy with Ethereum, and but we also have some other projects with Hyperledger Fabric, for example. But the most part is actually on Ethereum. Mm-hmm. And if this is a personal question, which SSI framework I use, I have experimented with a lot of different DIDs. I personally feel like to implement self-sovereign identity solution, Hyperledger Indy is the most appropriate one, since it is especially designed to support self-sovereign identity. But there are also other self-sovereign identity providers, for example, Fiolocom I showed earlier, which are pretty great and which I enjoy working with.
Okay, so if you're using Ethereum as a framework, then who does pay for the transaction costs, since probably every request of a SSI or DID has some transaction costs that either the user or like another entity has to pay? Is it right?
That's a good question, which is but also easy to answer. Since we're developing applications in closed systems, so for example in the refugee camp, where has no possibility to interact with the regular internet, it is not necessary for us to have like a proof of work consensus mechanism established, or a proof of stake, or something else that requires transaction costs. We use their simple proof of authority consensus mechanism that doesn't require any transaction costs, and it's also way quicker.
Oh, okay, I get it. So basically, you're forking Ethereum then, and using the Ethereum blockchain language as.
We're not forking it. We deploy it like an Ethereum blockchain by ourselves.
Ah, yeah.
Where it can set and the gas costs and stuff like this.
All right, let's come to the next question. That's actually also interesting. So Amazon and other companies are usually pretty interested in collecting the user data, and what incentives can be provided to encourage providers to accept those SSIs?
That's an excellent question. So far, we cannot force online services to adopt self-sovereign identity. But still, it would make sense for them as just the maintenance of all these databases that store the personal information costs so much money for them. It would just make a benefit for them monetary-wise, since they don't need to store that data anymore. The second part is that it also saves costs on the other side. For example, if you have a trusted verified ID that is backed with an actual ID credential that is valid, then you don't need to have know your customer processes, which also cost a lot. And so these are some incentives for the online services to use it. There's one thing that is pretty cool. Like when you share this information, you can implement chameleon hashes. That's a one-time hash that can only be used one, and once it's provided a second time, it's not valid anymore. So that's a new concept, which I think was a published paper last year, which is very interesting and which would solve the problem that these companies or these online services would find a way to use your personal data. But it's contrary to the current process that data is being collected and sold, since that's one of the main goals that SSI wants to achieve, is to prevent that data is sold without your explicit consent.
So the next question is kind of related to it. So Eurocom, it was like shown as a button next to Facebook login, Google login, and so on. Basically, Eurocom has to collect your data and act as a similar provider as Google or Facebook. So where would be the difference between Google or Facebook? So it would be basically another company managing your data, kind of?
Yeah, also a good question. Therefore, I would remember you to the comparison slide I did, where there were these four online service providers, which all have part of your identity. And on self-sovereign identity, the identity was in the middle. Hereby, I mean that the information you have on your wallet, like on your device, doesn't leave the device. So you attest information to your identity, but it's only on the wallet. And the only way others can see the data is when you actively share this. So compared to Google or Facebook, where you have to provide an identity, which is then stored on their servers, where you can change them, like where you're uploading the information you have. That's the difference between self-sovereign identity, like Yolocom, where it's only on your device, and so decentralized, and Google, where your information is then stored on any of their servers as a centralized identity provider.
Would an SSI make it impossible, or would it prevent Google from, for example, identifying you over browser fingerprinting, for example, since you still are using Google? Or maybe Amazon is a better example for this. When you're like shopping and then sending articles to your household, then basically SSI would still not.
Yeah, true. I think the problem you're referring to is that many current businesses or processes we have on the internet rely on that these services have your information stored somewhere. If you want to online shop and to send it to you, you can, like an example I've seen it worked exactly like you are doing it now, besides the fact that you don't have an actual account, but only share like on a checkout, you share your address where it needs to be shipped to with the form of a credential request. The credential sharing itself prevents the online services in order to make it very difficult to store these data behind the actual credential presentation. And there's also a revoking functionality. So every credential you present, you can also revoke that presentation again as soon as you want, so that this information isn't located on the online server side. However, customer binding is a challenge that is also on the list here.
Right. Yeah, maybe it isn't even in your interest to stop Amazon from getting this information, sure, where to ship or which advertisement to show, because, well, you do want to get interesting products and not, like, I don't know, Pampers as a student.
It's also worth to mention that you don't want the world to know who you are. As you just said, in some cases you want to. The main benefit of SSI is that you have the control with whom you do share this data, and that you have the possibility to revoke the data if you want to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's get move on to the next question. So there isn't an approach by IOTA for a digital identity. So would it be feasible? Maybe you know about it and can explain what it is. For example, I don't know about it.
Yes, I looked at that in my thesis, but I didn't look very closely to it. And maybe whoever asked the question may confirm me that they are using a distributed hash graph where these process of how the DID is created and updated and manage in general is located in there. I really like the idea that that IoT devices have their own identities, and that's also part of the potential use case I mentioned. Therefore, it all depends on how the wallet will look like and how the connection will be made to IOTA's Tangle. I have to admit, I didn't look very closely into that, but from what I saw, it was very promising and would be a great fit for IoT devices.
All right, so the next question is related to your slides. Will you upload them, or maybe Jonas knows, next to the video, will they be published? Otherwise, people can also like review the presentation and see the slides, apparently.
From my side, I can upload them. I think I will talk with Jonas or with Flavio or with you about it.
Yeah, Martin, if you want, could you maybe after the presentation share it in the chat here? So that interesting people can then directly use it. For me, it's easier to communicate with us on LinkedIn or via email.
Yeah.
I think this would be a good solution who's really interested.
Perfect. Yeah, I can do that.
Great.
So, Martin, which SSI do you recommend for trying out, like provider or service?
Yes, good question. There are many different tutorials you can do. For example, I like the one from Eurocom very much, as they have a very broad field of use cases where you can try it out. I can also recommend from Sovereign itself, so the European Union or the European Commission has a test set already up. It's called EBSI tutorial. LISI is a German corporation or research project that also provides some sort of an identity tutorial, which is very cool. So feel free to Google whatever you want with self-sovereign identity tutorials. I'm pretty sure they are all pretty solid and show very good the benefits of self-sovereign identity.
So what would be a use case where you can use a self-sovereign identity to log in or to provide information? Is there like any
This will be then self-asserted. So you will be requested to enter a name, email address, something like this, which you don't have to answer truthfully. But you will be just requested to enter this data by yourself for now. That's the problem I mentioned earlier with the missing trust anchors. So far, these tutorials are mostly all mocked. We're waiting for getting the trust anchors into the system.
Okay, so how do you see the potential of zero knowledge proof in the context of self-sovereign identities? Maybe we should quickly explain what zero knowledge proofs are. Do you want to do this?
Yes, sure, I can go ahead. Zero knowledge proofs are basically yes or no questions that you can ask about a specific data set. So the zero knowledge, when you ask a question, for example, are you over 18? You don't say, I am born on the 1st of January 2000, but you just answer yes. So the receiver of the information just knows exactly what he's asking for, and not additional information like your date of birth. And that's also the potential for self-sovereign identity, especially with the credentials. There are many, many potential ways or use cases where you can ask, are you a German resident? Are you over 18 years old? are you male? Something like this. That's perfect example for how you can use zero knowledge proofs with self-sovereign identity.
Yeah, I agree. So basically, I thought that SSIs are all kind of based on zero knowledge proofs, where you can, if you, for example, enter a club, so the bouncer just needs to know that you are eligible and over 18 to go there, but he doesn't know to check your ID and see how old you are actually.
Yeah.
That would be, for example, I don't know, viable for parties. 30 yeah, parties where you only are allowed to go so yeah. people could hide. Yeah. I'm over 18.
Yeah. yeah. Or for example, online casinos. Or exactly. If you're creating a bank account or something where you need to be over 18, for example.
Yeah, let's move on. So how does Microsoft DID on Bitcoin network addresses this problem?
The Ion network, which is the DID method from Microsoft and some others on the Bitcoin blockchain, is very interesting. The thing is with Bitcoin, when you have an identity there, like just having the private public private keys is basically already a self-sovereign identity. Based on the definition, you can independently create it, you can manage it however you want to. That also works with the BTCR DID method. And with Ion, they implement the Psytree protocol for that, which also a DID method I looked at for my master thesis. And right now, the main problem it solves is the super long transaction times that Bitcoin takes. So this goes super fast on the identity overlay network they were implementing. So far, I don't know if they have a tutorial or anything besides that DID method. They solve the problem of the long transaction duration or transaction confirmation in Bitcoin. Everything on top of that is defined on the wallet. However, if you have this Ion DID, in the end with Hyperledger areas, it should be possible to use that like any other DID as well.
Mm-hmm. So the next question is, what is the advantage of a self-sovereign identity over the available electronic identification card from the government? So basically we all have an ID that potentially can have an electronic service attached to it, but I think nobody is using it kind of. So similar to the SSI, it's like, yeah, not used.
Yeah. Also a very good question. That also comes back to the problem of trust anchors. Right now, we don't have them. So I know that YOLOCOM did a POC with the Bundesbürgerei where they read from your identity card, from the chip in your identity card, your identity, and then asserted a verifiable credential to your YOLOCOM ID. If you have this YOLOCOM ID, then the advantage is immense, and you can prove online that you about everything that stands on your ID card. Right now, due to the lack of trust anchors in the system, there is no real advantage to that, besides some self-attested claim or claims that don't have this level of trust as like an official and digital ID that you get from your electronic identification card.
Would it be possible to combine the EID with the SSI, for example, if I use my e-identification card with that reader, that it only provides the information that is needed. I'm not sure if the government is working on that or not, but that would be potentially interesting if the government would offer an SSI.
Yeah, absolutely. The government somehow is already working on that problem, but it's on the EU, Europe-wide, on the EU mm-hmm. Commission. And they had launched an pre-commercial procurement at the beginning of the year, where companies were asked how a self-sovereign identity solution based on the European blockchain service infrastructure could look like. And I think that takes a bit. I think the actual tender, like where you can apply for solutions like this, will be open end of this year or beginning of next year. So they are working on that. Thankfully, they have identified the problem that we should use a verified digital ID online. It just takes a while.
Mm-hmm. Would that mean an end to all those services like YOLOCOM if the EU or a government would provide such an SSI, since these services wouldn't be necessary anymore?
No, absolutely not. I would say it's the opposite. Like, they benefit from the credentials you get from that DID, and you can choose between which service you like most. So if you prefer to use the wallet and everything provided from the European Commission that is highly integrated with your DID and your wallet there, then you can use that. But you can also transfer the DID to other wallets. So you can also have an EBSI DID on your YOLOCOM or Sovereign or whatever wallet. So that doesn't make a big difference. I think in the end, it's based on personal preferences. In the end, the DIDs should be able to do all the same. And therefore, it wouldn't make a big difference.
Okay. So Christoph asked is if blockchain is only used for the storage of the DIDs, or also credentials are stored on the blockchain?
There are some basic rules in self-sovereign identity, and one of them is never ever put credentials on the blockchain. Because everyone can read it, and that would absolutely violate the wish for more data privacy. And also, I can't think of a benefit that would have. Then I want to mention again that the blockchain itself isn't used as a data storage. And the data storage is your wallet or your the wallet on your smartphone or on your personal computer. It's only there to create a DID or to use the public keys, public and private key pair, to create a DID. There's only little information on the blockchain in relation to self-sovereign identity. What, for example, credential issuers could put on there is a so-called revocation registry, where the IDs of the credentials are listed, so that if you present your credential that is not valid anymore, that is being revoked from the credential issuer to third parties, they could then check on that revocation registry on the blockchain if the credential is still valid or not. But there's no real not a lots of data on the blockchain.
Okay, so somebody asked if you could compare Sovereign and LISI, maybe quickly get back what those two are.
So Sovereign is one of the earliest creators of a self-sovereign identity network, and also incredibly involved in the creation of the standards and creation of Hyperledger Indy, like the self-sovereign identity ledger that is built for SSI, and they provided a very comprehensive governance model with many great ideas, for example, to transfer ownership to others. So they're someone lately compared to it, like that sovereign is what Bitcoin is to blockchain, and they're doing really great work. Lissy is a German research project that was created this year. It is open to German industries that just help to create like a framework for how companies can use self-sovereign identity for their purposes. But they also have tutorials. I can absolutely recommend taking a look at both of them. They are super interesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so how is the DID based? How is it linked to a real-world identity, such a passport or equivalent government documents? So maybe the next question, though, those both questions are kind of related. So
So how is the DID connected with a real-world identity? I hope I understood that question correctly. Yeah. It is not connected as long there is no digital option or digital version of your offline credentials attached to it. A DID is just an online identifier where you can access services, for example, without anyone knowing who you actually are. And you said a passport or an equivalent government document. This totally depends on the digital credentials or verifiable credentials you have in your wallet.
Can you get digital credentials of your passport or governmental document right now? So government has to issue that, right, first?
Yeah. I mean, you can request it theoretically, but I don't know of any service that is currently available for everyone to do it. Mm-hmm. Maybe in Estonia or something, they are pretty ahead with
probably
digital identities, but not that I know of here in Germany.
So I think in your presentation you showed the identifier that it stays the same.
Yeah.
And if you connect this identifier, if I understand right, with like more offline information, could you de-anonymize a person who is using an SSI?
So I don't fully get this question, but I'm trying to answer that. The identifier is static, yes. And the DID document contains information about the DID, like the public key or service endpoints. But in the DID document, is never or should never be written clear names. Like there's the DID is identified over public keys, like over not human readable data. So if you refer to the DID document, it's already
anonymized.
De-anonymized. However, that again depends on which DID you're using. There might be some purpose for the DID that, or some DID method that allows you to attach not like a clear name data to it. But so far, that's not the goal of SSI.
Okay, so basically, if you want to stay anonymous in like with an SSI, you shouldn't provide your real name, basically.
Yeah.
I think this is a bit of a redundant question. So how or where can we use an SSI, as you said, right now?
right now, I don't know a real life example where I can use it. We at Datorella trying to work on provide a use case where we provide SSI to some of our users. But that's in a very early stage, and I would say this will be coming in the next few years, hopefully, that it will be widely usable. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and what blockchain framework generally supports SSI? So you mentioned that you are using Ethereum and others are using Hyperledger Fabric or Indie. Can you implement an SSI on every blockchain, or are certain blockchains especially useful for that?
Yes. there are almost 70 DID methods that allow you to create a DID from any ledger or any blockchain. There's one for Ethereum, there's one for Bitcoin. There's Hyperledger Indie, which is my personally preferred ledger to create a self-sovereign identity solution. It's totally up to the user if you want to create a self-sovereign identity compatible DID method. This DID method has some requirements. So you have to define how you create a DID, how you update it, how you read from it, how you delete it or revoke it, and also how you build your DID document, how you get from your keys to the DID. If you have that defined for your ledger, you can then have your own DID method. So far, who's using it? Yes. there are 70 DID methods available. You can look online if you Google DID method registry. There's a list of the W3C consort, W3C, that has it all listed, and that shows what you need to have, or you need to do in order to create an SSI on a supported blockchain framework.
Okay. Are there also specialized blockchain frameworks that are offering only SSIs, or would it be useful for maybe optimizing the privacy or generally performance of an SSI to build only a blockchain for this?
I think it is important to differentiate between the blockchain itself and the wallet that it's adopting. Mm-hmm. As I said, Hyperledger Indie is especially made for enabling self-sovereign identity. So that's the way to go for your first question. And the second part was, can you repeat the second part of the question again?
I actually forgot what I asked. So I asked whether there are like specialized frameworks or blockchains for SSI, yeah, or whether it would be practical to create a blockchain only for SSI purposes that would be especially optimized for performance or privacy.
That privacy and performance thing. Since there's only a minimal transaction with the ledger itself, it doesn't have to be absolutely high performing. Mm-hmm. I mean, on Bitcoin, when it takes 1 hour, that's maybe not so ideal. But that's why Ion was implemented, for example. And then with privacy respect, that is, I think, very well covered with the existing standards of verifiable presentation and where you then share your information with others and where you can revoke it, and that is more on the wallet. Mm-hmm. On the wallet layer. Yeah.
All right, and let's come to the last question from Johannes. So, how did you implement credential definitions, revocation registries, and so on in Ethereum or other non-indie approaches to SSI? That sounds like a rather technical question, so I'm not sure if you want to share your screen and show the like your animations or your illustrations again, or whether you can answer that without.
Let me try it without.
All right.
So credential definitions and revocation registries are indie based, and other ledgers don't have this explicitly supported. If I remember correctly, so right now I think they just went without, and to me that would mean that these credentials need to have their own publicly known identifier that you can request it. The question is, for example, when you have an ID, that would better be globally defined, how that would look like, independent of which blockchain framework you are using. I don't know how it is with others. I guess within their own system, they have, like, they know how the credential looks like, and they know what they need to request. And that's a good question that I cannot fully answer, but I hope it answers the question well enough.
All right. So I would say that the numbers of questions shows how interesting this topic are and how interested the audience was in those questions or in this topic. And yeah, I guess this topic will be one of the hottest topics in the next 5 years when SSIs get more established on the internet. So I would give back to Jonas for some final words.
Perfect. Then thanks, Arthur. And also thank you, Martin, for these very nice and detailed Q&A session. So lots of your participants really stayed until the end, and lots of good and also quite technical questions, I guess, as far as I can judge. So thank you all for participating. Thank you, Martin. And of course, you are all welcome to follow Martin if you're interested in SSI stuff, and also follow me, of course, if you're interested in this meetup stuff we are doing here in our events. So as I said in the beginning, we will have another meetup at 30th of June with blockchain startups, and then in the middle of July, an event panel discussion with members of the ECB, Libra Association, and some others. So yeah, we would love all of you to join these presentations, of course. And again, thanks, Martin, for being here today. I hope it was also fun for you. And yeah, many thanks to all of you.
Yeah, it was much fun. Thank you very much for having me. And thank you for the excellent questions. I really enjoyed being here. And if you have any questions, feel free to follow me on LinkedIn or send me an email at martin.scheffner@trella.com. I also provided the slides here in the chat earlier.
Yeah, the people said that the access is not working, so they request the access. Yeah.
Okay. Then maybe save the link before you leave, and I change the.
Okay. Then I will also leave the chat open for 5 more minutes, that all people can access the slides then.
Yeah. Perfect.
Perfect. So again, thanks, Martin, and have a great evening, and take care.
Yes, you too. Thank you very much.